it's a key role that you played very heavily on this new Kanye West album, Donda. Is it fair to say you touched every song?
Yeah, I mixed the whole thing.
That's crazy, man. So, man, story time. How does it start? Where does the journey start? First with linking with Kanye and then getting involved with the project?
Oh, for sure. I started mixing for him in 2009 or so. So it's been about 10 years. But over the decade, I've done singles and little things here and there, never an entire project. And this was my first album that I've done for him entirely from the beginning to the end. So that was amazing. That was a great experience. It was, you know, whatever you may imagine, it's exactly that. So it was definitely stressful. Definitely a lot of, you know, go time. Definitely a lot of, you know, they squeezed the heck out of me, you know, that's for sure. But it was great. And the cool thing is that I was given almost complete freedom in terms of mixing choices and things like that. So what you hear on the album is exactly what I envisioned.
So what's that initial conversation like? Because I know Kanye is very involved with every part of the process. I know you said you were left to your own devices almost, but were you given like any sort of framework or direction?
Yes, yes. So he was very, very, and has always been very clear about no reverb and no delays on his vocals. That's been the case since day one. But even more so for this thing, since it was like such a large album with a lot of guests. And of course, any, you know, any singer, any rapper that's featured usually have their own treatment, their own thing, you know. So that was a little bit tricky to make sure that I could be true to Ye's vision for his own vocals, but then at the same time have a similar, you know, it have to work. The whole thing had to work with the guests. And so, you know, it was a little bit of that. But no, other than that, you know, he's very clear with his indications. And he gave me directions on that. But then it was all me. So basically the music, all the like the relationships between the different components of the song, like, you know, say there was like a synth and a guitar or something. Sometimes the producers wants to be very, they want to be very hands-on with the ratios or whatever. Not here. It's all me, basically. It's all me. One time I had delivered, I don't know, maybe like the third or fourth song or something like that. And he called me. At the time, my phone was broken, so I couldn't answer like this. I had to put it on speakerphone, and there were other people in the room when I was doing that. And he calls, and he was like yelling like, "Oh my God, man, I'm elated by these mix." He said elated. And he was yelling, you know, and that was hilarious. And, you know, what a moment right there. And when I hung up, I was like, this just happened. That was really funny.
Man, that's crazy. So I want to get a kind of an idea of the timeline, because it felt like this album was evolving. There was a lot of events, like supposed release parties. It was a very unique rollout. So from the first time you started working on the album to the release day, how long were you involved, do you reckon?
It was about a month.
That's a lot shorter than I thought.
Yeah, considering 30 songs, that's kind of quick, you know, like considering that all the revisions had to be made while mixing the rest. I had to go, man. Especially the beginning, I was running on that thing, you know, and it's one of those things, you know, the more time you spend on something, the better it is. Period. Until you get to a point where you're just wasting time. But in the beginning, you know, it took a while. It took a while to get into, you know, at least like 20 plus songs to be dialed in properly. And in fact, truth be told, if I had the possibility to have another maybe week or so, it would have been better, of course. But, you know, it is what it is. It was every waking hour, basically. It was, you know, rocking out the whole time, you know, no breaks at all. Yeah, especially at the end where everything is ramping up, you know, the labels hitting me up, managers hitting me up, you know, Ye's hitting me up about stuff. It was like very intense, you know.
What track do you reckon you made that the biggest call and it's affected the sonics of the song the most on that album?
That will be all of them. So once I have you know, the second I'm sitting in front of a mix session, and that happens with any song that I mix, you know, of course I have everything multi-track, so I can pick and choose whatever I want to feature more or less of and where, spatially and time-wise, right? So it was totally my call to figure out if I wanted to have this synth to be the prominent one versus that one or whatever the case, you know? And some indication did come from some producers, like normal, but for the most part, it was my call to go with this or with that, you know? The rough mixes that I have received, a lot of them sounded like, you know, just two-track mixes, like where no decisions really had been taken. So I did the whole thing from scratch. And usually what I do is I get familiar with the session. I get the session familiar with me. And then once I kind of have a game plan, then that's when I start moving faders. I don't jump into it until I know what I'm going to do. So the decision of having this to be the carrying instrument or riff or whatever is totally up to me.
So in terms of, well, that might answer the next question, but were there any songs that were particularly easier or more challenging to get right or get to that final point, whether it be from the actual amount of stems to the song getting updated a few times over that period of the month?
Yeah, the edits usually made my life a little bit more difficult, because it was like, okay, let's shorten verse 2 by 3 bars or 4 bars, not 3, but 4 bars, right? And then, so I gotta trim everything. And then maybe 2 days later, another revision comes in like, hey, let's undo that. Let's go back to full verse. So now I gotta extend the stuff out again, you know, so that means I gotta move all of my automations, all of my sessions, and be able to potentially undo whatever I just did, you know, because a lot of times, especially for the newer songs, that some were still in the discovery phase, like we were still trying to figure out what the layout was going to be. Not all, actually most of them were solidified. I want to say maybe 3/4 of the songs we didn't do any of this, but with the newer ones there were a little bit of, you know, let me see. So that was a pain. That was, I didn't like that.
No, I can imagine. So how does it feel like when you come to the end of that process? Because like I saw a video of Kanye shouting you out, like giving props to your engineering on the project. Then
we had this engineer, IRKO, did an amazing job.
And yo, that must feel crazy, because like Kanye West is undoubtedly one of the greatest like musicians of our generation. So like, how does it feel to get that recognition and then to just execute on such a high level in such a short period of time?
Yeah, that was great. When that interview came out, my phone, anytime all of these things happen, my phone blows up with notifications like, hey, you know, this happened. And I'm always here. I'm always working. So I'm not really paying attention to that stuff until enough notifications come about something, then I will. And so it was great, especially like you said, you know, having such a, you know, major, you know, artist shouting me out. That was great. Of course, when I heard that, my bow tie went spinning.
that's crazy. But were you involved with the Donda player at all? What are your thoughts on it? Because it's a pretty unique idea to actually almost popularize, like in the mainstream, accessing stems.
Yeah, those are my stems. Yeah, I did all the files for it.
I was looking at the gram and I don't even like lights. I was screaming at my daddy, told me it ain't Christ-like. I was screaming at the referee just like Mike. Looking for a bright light, Seagull, what your life like? Riding on a white bike, feeling like a sight flight. Riding on a white bike, feeling like...
So, but did that add much extra work in terms of getting it ready for that format? Or was it quite a smooth transition getting into the stem player?
A little bit. I just talked to the engineer behind the stem player, and he asked me, you know, we had a conversation about what was the best way to deliver and how to deliver the files. And but then, you know, no, it was simple. I mean, it's not much different than to print a mix. It's just that mix is getting printed onto 4 different tracks instead of one, right? So no, it was a little bit time consuming because the album is 2 hours long, but it wasn't crazy, you know. Yeah, that was cool. In fact, I want one. I don't have one. I guess I have the files here.
You've got the raw files in front of you, so you are the stem player, IRKO.
Right, that's right.
Bo, before we wrap up, I've got to ask you, and I know it's like picking your favorite child, but back to Donda, if you had to pick your favorite song, what would it be?
Well, Hurricane, obviously the magnitude of that song is a big one.
All lights out for me, all lights out for me, lightning strikes the beach, 80 degrees, warm it up for me, finally free.
Moon, another one that's special, no drums, you know, very spacey kind of vibe, you know. It's hard to pick one, you know. They're all special in their own right, you know.
Yeah, no,
maybe those two.
Yeah, I know that's a difficult question, but I had to throw it out there. But man, we appreciate your time and congratulations on the project, man. Like incredible work, and the story is crazy to know the time period, and just the intensity of it. So yeah, congratulations.
Thank you very much, man.
But yeah, man, this has been the Producer Room, powered by Producer Culture, the legend IRKO. We'll catch you on the next one. Peace.
Thank you so much.